Welcome back, everybody. Let's continue to talk about probability. The last time we were together, we talked about three different rules of probability. This time, I want to talk about a special situation with computing probability. It's known as sampling with replacement. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Now that we're familiar with those three rules, these examples are going to make more sense. Computing probabilities based on sampling with replacement is really just like computing basic probabilities that we've done in the past, with one critical difference. And the difference is that when we use sampling with replacement, each time we compute a probability, we assume that we're dealing with, for example, a full deck of cards. We're going to go through a couple examples using playing cards in just a minute, so you'll see exactly what I mean. The reason that we should be familiar with this whole concept of sampling with replacement is because some statistical theories are based on sampling with replacement. In fact, when we start computing inferential statistics, the probabilities that we compute are based on sampling with replacement. So we will replicate the examples on this page. Let's switch views and jump right into it. So that you can see the difference very clearly, we'll compute these probabilities with replacement and without. In this first example, let's compute the probability of randomly selecting three red cards from a deck of 52 without using sampling with replacement. So in this case, we'll compute probability just like we did before. When it comes to randomly selecting cards, each selection is independent of the other, so we can use rule number three. We can figure out the probability of selecting one red card, then the probability of selecting a second red card, and then the probability of selecting a third red card, and just multiply those three probabilities to find their joint occurrence. Let's first figure out the probability of selecting that first red card. Remember, there are 52 playing cards, and I might not have mentioned this previously, but half of them are red and half of them are black. So what's the number of ways that a red card could occur? At this point, we have a full deck, so there are 26 red cards. There are 26 ways that a red card could occur out of 52 total. We're going to multiply that by the probability of selecting that second red card. So what's the number of ways that a red card can occur? If we've already selected a red card, there are only 25 left. So now there are 25 red cards out of 51 total. And now let's set up the probability for randomly selecting that third red card. There are now only 24 red cards left, and there are only 50 cards left overall. So we can find the joint occurrence by multiplying those three fractions. I mentioned to you that I like using fractions in these more complicated examples. I find the fractions just more intuitive to look at. I mean, when you look at that first fraction, 26 out of 52, that makes a lot of sense just when you look at it. And then also, when we write the fractions this way, we're only doing rounding at the last step, and sometimes that's nice because you're going to see the difference between this first example and the second example is really very small, and we need to go out several decimal places just to see the difference. So let's go ahead and multiply this out. Let's multiply the numerators first. We've got 26 times 25 times 24. That equals 15,600. Let's multiply all of those denominators, 52 times 51 times 50. That equals 132,600. So we are left with 15,600 divided by 132,600. Those are big numbers, but it's no big deal. Our calculators can handle it. Let's figure out our final answer, 15,600 divided by 132,600. That equals 0.1176. That's like 11.76%. 0.1176. Again, I'm going to go out several decimal places just so we can see the slight difference between these first couple examples. So if we're randomly selecting cards from a deck of cards, only about 12% of the time will we randomly select three red cards. These first two examples are essentially identical, but in that second example, we're going to use sampling with replacement. Let's talk about our first selection. How many ways can we find a red card? There are 26 red cards in that deck of 52. Because we're using sampling with replacement, once we select that first card, we're now going to put it right back in the deck. So now when we select the second card, we need to ask ourselves how many red cards are in the deck. Well, we're using sampling with replacement, so there are again 26 red cards in that deck out of 52. And again, as we move on to that third selection, we're using sampling with replacement in this example. So there are 26 red cards in that deck out of 52 cards total. Let's go ahead and crunch that out. Let's multiply the numerators. 26 times 26 times 26 equals 17,576. Let's multiply the denominators. 52 times 52 times 52 equals 140,608. So we're left with 17,576 divided by 140,608. Let's crunch that out. 17,576 divided by 140,608 equals 0.125. So in other words, when we use sampling with replacement, randomly selecting three red cards from that deck will occur about 12.5% of the time. You can see that these answers are pretty close, but they're not the same. So sampling with replacement does make a slight difference. Let's go through another pair of examples. These again are very similar. The only difference is that one example uses sampling with replacement and the other example does not. Let's read through it. There are 10 red, 5 green, and 10 yellow M&Ms. What's the probability of drawing a red M&M, which you eat, and then another red one? This is just kind of a clever way of showing that this example does not use sampling with replacement. If you eat that one red M&M, you obviously can't replace it. So in this case, we'll be computing probability just like we learned originally. Let's start by computing the probability of randomly selecting that first red M&M. So what's the number of ways that a red M&M can occur? What's the number of ways that it could be selected? There are 10 red M&Ms, so there are 10 ways. What's the total number of all outcomes? In other words, what's the total number of all M&Ms that we're dealing with? 10 red, 5 green, 10 yellow, that's 25 M&Ms total. When we're selecting one M&M and then another M&M, those selections are completely independent, so we can multiply their individual probabilities to find the joint probability. After we've eaten that red M&M, what's now the probability of selecting another red M&M? Well, if we started off with 10 red M&Ms, there must be 9 left now. And if we started off with 25 M&Ms total, there must be 24 now. Let's crunch that out. Let's look at the numerators first. 10 times 9 equals 90. And now let's multiply the denominators. 25 times 24 equals 600. So we're left with 90 divided by 600. And that equals 0.15. So in other words, about 15% of the time in this situation, we're going to select one red M&M, eat it, and then select another red M&M. Look at the next example. You'll see it's exactly the same, but now we're being asked, what's the probability of drawing a red M&M, which you replace, and then another red one? So we're clearly using sampling with replacement. Let's start by computing the probability of randomly selecting that first M&M and having it turn up red. How many ways can a red M&M occur? There are 10 red M&Ms, so we've got 10. How many M&Ms are there total? There are 25. So we're going to take that first M&M that we selected and we're going to throw it back in. So again, when we're talking about now selecting that second M&M, what's the probability that it turns out red? How many red M&Ms are in there? There are 10. And how many M&Ms are in there total? Because we're using sampling with replacement, there are 25 again in that bag of M&Ms. let's multiply those two individual probabilities to find the joint probability. Numerators first, 10 times 10 equals 100. Now let's multiply the denominators, 25 times 25 equals 625. So we're left with 100 divided by 625, and that equals 0.16. So in other words, about 16% of the time, this situation will occur, in which on our first selection, we will find a red M&M, we'll toss it back in, and then for our second selection, we will find another red M&M. So again, when we compare the two, we can see those numbers are pretty close, but they are a little bit different. So sampling with replacement does have at least somewhat of an effect. Why are we talking about sampling with replacement? We're talking about it because the probabilities we will be computing for inferential statistics are based on sampling with replacement. Well, I think that's enough for right now. In the next video, we'll talk just a little bit more about joint probabilities, and I'll also introduce you to conditional probabilities. We'll do that in the next video. In the meantime, be safe.